जा रहा था तो उत्तरायण के सामने से गुजरा तो देखा गुरुदेव उस कड़ी धूप में गर्मी में बरामदे में बैठे, आई होप यू अंडरस्टैंड हिंदी, आई विल गिव अ पैराफ्रेज लेटर इन इंग्लिश, बैठे चित्र बना रहे थे। मैं वहाँ गया तो मैंने कहा कि इतनी गर्मी में आप यहाँ बैठे हैं, तो उन्होंने कहा विधाता ने मुझे वैशाख में धरती पे भेजा था कि मैं गर्मी से ना डरूं, और उपनयन के वक्त मैंने प्रण किया था, यू नो व्हेन यू आर गिवन द सेक्रेट थ्रेड यू हैव टू मेक ए वॉ, तो उस वक्त मैंने प्रण किया था कि दिन में सोऊंगा नहीं, तो मैं दिन में सोता नहीं हूँ और ये वक्त मैं चित्र बनाने में लगाता हूँ। उन्होंने लिखा कि वो फूल का चित्र बना रहे थे तो वो रंग जो सामने था उनको पसंद नहीं आया, तो एक फूल को ही लेके उन्होंने कागज़ के ऊपर मसल दिया और उसी से रंग दिया। दैट्स द वे ही वर्कड, एंड प्रोबेबली उनको रंग पसंद नहीं आया, आई डिडंट लाइक द कलर बिकॉज नाउ इट इज़ रिवील्ड दैट टैगोर वॉज कलर ब्लाइंड टू रेड एंड ग्रीन। आई डोंट नो इफ दिस इज, सो दिस इज अमेजिंग that one of our finest painters and colorists was colorblind, but people like him who are sent by some divine providence, they go beyond all these limitations. It is very appropriate that the exhibition started with this song, Ami Tumi, Ami Chiningo Chiningo. So my O Bideshini, as Abhijit mentioned, the Bideshini of this song is indeed Victoria Ocampo, and she was the one who was responsible for fixing, through her connections in Paris, the Galerie Pigalle, where the first exhibition of Tagore's paintings took place in 1930. In India it came later, after having toured various venues in Europe. Now, one has a view of the Bengal school of art that it looked back only, that it was sentimental and all that. But Jodashanko, the Tagore household, which had people like Gabanindranath Tagore and Gaganindranath Tagore, was open to all kinds of influences. And if you look at, for example, Gaganindranath Tagore's work, he is influenced by Cubism. Similarly, in some of the works of Tagore, which you'll see here, you'll find traces of Cubism. Tagore was exposed to modern Western art also, and therefore he stands apart from the rest of the Bengal school, because he was trying to express what he could not, send ideas. They can never be like the product of a photographic camera. His art is not about realistic depiction. People often ask me about the meaning of my pictures. I remain silent even as my pictures are. It is for them to express and not to explain. And then he says, the world speaks to me in colors, which is curious because one wonders how the world of colors would have seemed to him. I had a friend, he's now settled abroad, we were together in college and university and all, who was also blind to red and green, and my duty used to be to mix and match his clothes so that he won't wear red trousers with green shirts. And I once asked him what the colors looked like to him. And he told me that both green and red, he knew grass was green and he knew blood was red, but that's about all. But he said that they all looked like chocolate color to him. I don't know if the dark palette of Tagore has something to do with this, or whether it is because of his use of flowers and inks and paints and whatever came to his hand as medium. So that's very interesting. But he was very conscious about his art, even though it is titled The Last Harvest. But then, as in the case of Goethe, the last period of Tagore's life, when he was racked by pain, by illness and all, is poetically also among his most creative periods. The last period, I think, personally, some of my favorite poems of Tagore are from this last period. And this is where probably he had realized that in his last, very last poem which he dictated, he said that, "I have given to the world what I had to give. And now if some kindness is given to me," I think Abhijit would remember this, the original Bengali poem, "I can take it in the bark which takes me to the other shore." So that's the sense of a sailor who has sailed all over the seas and now come to the harbor. And these paintings from his last period are again deep expressions. I remember years ago having read a psychological or psychoanalytical study of the paintings, where it was mentioned that they expressed some kind of a repression which came out. And maybe that's why he said whatever he could not express through words, he expressed through images. Now, Professor Shivkumar Saab referred to the frequency of a female face in his paintings. Again, in an interview, he said that it was very unfortunate that one who was very dear to him, he was referring to his sister-in-law, he was very attached to her and she was attached to him, but when he got married, she committed suicide. So maybe this memory was somewhere at the back of his mind, which he could not express otherwise in words. And he said that this face haunted him, and that's what recurs in the paintings. I think Professor Shivkumar Saab probably would throw more light on this, but this is what I remember having read. So, about Tagore's works, one can only say what he said, that nature hates, Tagore said, nature hates superlatives. We can be sure of the great, but not the greatest. But I would say that he certainly, if not the greatest, is certainly among the greatest of Indian artists. And being completely self-taught, along with those other self-taught artists who are prominent in the modern arts pantheon, Henri Rousseau and Gauguin, he certainly is no less than any of those. And the sheer volume of the output, 2,500 odd paintings, as Professor Saab mentioned, out of which about 2,000 are in India, fortunately, isn't it? About 2,000 in India, of which 1,500 are in Vishwabharati itself, which is a good fortune, because we are not good at keeping our own good things in the country. So it's a great occasion that out of this huge selection, this huge volume, a selection has been brought to Bangalore also. Tagore has written about art extensively. In fact, in his essay, titled The Artist, he says the only evidence of truth in art exists when it compels us to say, "I see." A donkey we may pass by in nature, but a donkey in art we must acknowledge, even if it be a creature that disreputably ignores all its natural history responsibility. Even if it resembles a mushroom in its head and a palm leaf in its tail. And this is what you see in his paintings. The paintings cry out and say, "See." And then he asks the question, "What is art?" At another place, he asks, "What is art?" And he answers, "It is the response of man's creative soul to the call of the real. And in his last phase, this was the preoccupation with him, the call of the real. And sometimes he's questioning about the faith also in the last poem. So the paintings and the last poems, they come together. And then he says, we know a thing because it belongs to a class. We see a thing because it belongs to itself. The idea is that these paintings, they are in themselves what they are. You don't have to find meanings in them. They are what they are. They express themselves. So take them as they are. Because then he says further at another place, art is for evoking in our mind the deep sense of reality in its richest aspect. The deep sense of reality in its richest aspect. And these are fantastic images that he has left behind. As has been pointed out, the beginning of his pictorial work were the erasures, which you, if you see the facsimile edition of Gitanjali, which has now been brought out by many publishers, including Vishwabharati, you see the erasures and how the lines connect, and then from these lines the figures emerge, and later on these figures go on to full-fledged pictures. And he said, Vidhata ne Vaishakh mein bheja hi isliye tha, to bana rahe hain. So that's the man, and enjoy the paintings. When this exhibition was taken to the Victoria and Albert Museum, I think the catalog was written by Professor Shiv Kumar only.
It's the same catalog.
Same. Yeah, so I would just read from that something which has been mentioned already by Professor Shiv Kumar. The works included in the exhibition were arranged around four themes. The imaginative works, focusing on animals or imaginary creatures, which are imbued with vitality and humor. Incidentally, we have the image of Tagore as a sage and all that, and there's something commented upon by someone like Neeraj Chaudhary also in his essay, Dui Rabindranath, the two Rabindranaths. He says Rabindranath before he wore this long robe and Rabindranath of pre-robe, this thing. But we have this image of a very serious sage-like person. But those who have read him in Bengali, and I learned Bengali basically to read Tagore in Bengali, know how humorous he is in some of his works. There is a great sense of humor in Tagore. So this you will find in the pictures also. Human figures are depicted either as individuals with expressive gestures or in groups in theatrical settings. In portraits produced during the 1930s, he renders the human face in a very reminiscent way of a mask or persona. And this is what I was referring to when he said that the haunting image of his dead sister-in-law recurred in these images. And then, of course, landscape subjects. I think some landscape subjects are included in this exhibition also, which we will all see. I, on behalf of everybody, not only in Bangalore but Karnataka, because I am sure people from other parts of Karnataka, at least art students from other institutions like Gulbarga, Davangere, Mysore, etc., would also come and see this exhibition. And on behalf of the people of Karnataka, I bow to all those who brought this exhibition to Bangalore. Thank you very much, sir. As I said, this is a long-awaited exhibition, and the natural follow-up to this should be the exhibition of Nandlal Bose's works, and after that, Binod Bihari Mukherjee's, because the reason is somehow here, part of Karnataka was Bombay Karnataka, therefore, The JJ School of Art is one stream which has come to Bangalore, I mean to Karnataka, and people are more attuned to the Bombay and Western, the Baroda, Bombay, JJ, that kind of stream, which was always placed in opposition to the Eastern School. And that Eastern School is not all sentimental works looking back towards Ajanta and miniatures. It's something which people have to discover here. So that's why I'm saying that after this, the natural follow-up is Nandlal Bose's exhibition and Vinod Bihari Mukherjee's exhibition.
Including Thank you. Jamini Roy.
Including Jamini Roy. Including Jamini Roy. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to be here today and share a few words with you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We indeed learn something new every time we listen to you. I would now like to request Dr. Rehana Shah, officer on special duty, to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Pankhuri. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As the OSD of the NGMA Bangalore, I am extremely delighted to thank Sri Chiranjeev Singh Ji, Chief Guest, Sri Abhijit Sen Gupta, Guest of Honor, and Sri Sudhakar Rao, Chairman of our Advisory Committee, for having accepted our invitation and devoted their valuable time to grace this occasion. It is also my privilege to thank the curator, Professor R. Sri Kumar, who has come all the way from Shantiniketan to participate in this occasion and kindly accepted to deliver the lecture tomorrow at 11 a.m. I take this opportunity to invite all of you to participate in this lecture. I also take the opportunity to thank the staff of NGMA Delhi who gave support during setting up of the exhibition. Sri K.G. Kumar, director of NGMA Bangalore, who had worked very hard to get this exhibition here despite many difficulties. Thank you, sir, for making this exhibition happen at Bangalore. I am indeed grateful to the lenders who have loaned their valuable art treasures from the prestigious collection of Ravindra Bhavan, Kala Bhavan, Vishwa Bharati, Shanti Niketan, and from NGMA New Delhi to make this exhibition a grand success. I would also like to thank all the guests who honored our invitation and came to the program despite adverse weather condition. I further invite all of you to view this exhibition and have a cup of tea thereafter. I extend my warm greetings and thanks to all of you. Thank you.